गुड मॉर्निंग। टुडे विल बी डिस्कसिंग ऑन द टॉपिक ऑफ सुपर एलिवेशन एंड द बेस फॉर द सुपर एलिवेशन वी हैव लेड इन द यस्टरडेज लेक्चर इन विच वी टॉक्ड अबाउट व्हाट हैपेंस व्हेन सेंट्रिफ्यूगल फोर्स कम्स इनटू पिक्चर इन योर हाईवे और इन योर सिस्टम। सो जस्ट टू रिवाइज अ बिट, yeah, just to revise a bit, we started with horizontal alignment yesterday and we saw that there are few things such as topography, obligatory points, unwillingness related to the project from the political party or from the adjoining villages. This all leads to the necessary actions to change the direction of your highway alignment. Otherwise we go for a straight alignment as far as possible. So wherever this change comes into picture, then we need to study about the horizontal alignment. And in with respect to that, the horizontal alignment, it consists of four main design aspects. First is the horizontal curves, then the super elevation, the widening, and the transition curves. So we started with horizontal curves and we saw a simple circular curve. It can be represented with the help of its radius r or its degree. And that degree of curve is nothing but if you have an arc length of 30 meters, so simply by the formula of arc length is equal to radius into degree in radians, you can come to a conclusion for this relationship that r is equal to 1720 upon d. Then we saw that in horizontal curves, what comes into picture is the centrifugal force, which is the unwanted force which tries to damage the vehicle by overturning it or either skidding it. So this is the formula for that centrifugal force. And if I just rearrange and keep P by W on one side, so that P by W is nothing but the centrifugal ratio, which we will be seeing, which we have seen further in the effects of centrifugal force. And in this effects, mainly there are two effects. One is the overturning effect on the outer wheel, about the outer wheels, and second is the skidding of the vehicle laterally outwards. So in overturning effect, we saw that we have two forces mainly to consider. One is the centrifugal force P and another is the self-weight W. And knowing all the distances of these forces as they are acting on the CG of a vehicle, then if we go on finding out the moments about this point B, because that's the outer wheel about which your overturning may happen in case the centrifugal force exceeds. So this is the overturning moment, this is the resisting moment, and for equilibrium they both should be same or equal in magnitude because both are opposite in direction, so they will balance out each other. And again, rearranging the equation in form of P by W, I get P by W is equal to B by 2H, which is nothing but the centrifugal ratio is equal to b by 2h. So if I am not providing a super elevation and if I have to avoid overturning of my vehicle, then this condition should be satisfied by the system of the highway and the vehicle that is running on the highway. Then the next is the transverse skidding effect. So in this, yesterday I forgot to share this, that this shaded portion that you see below the tires, that is nothing but the pressure under the inner and outer wheels. Okay. So again, this is the condition when we are not providing a super elevation, and though there is no super elevation, our vehicle is taking or traversing a curve. So in that case, there will be unequal distribution of the forces or pressure under these wheels, and that could also result in a wear and tear of the outer wheel of the vehicle rapidly as compared to the inner wheel. And then again in transverse skidding effect, we saw that in this, now the friction force comes into picture and the frictional factor comes into picture, which is the lateral coefficient of friction. And then again by balancing the forces, horizontal forces, we get this equation, that is the centrifugal ratio should be equal to the friction factor, lateral friction factor. And generally it is taken as minimum value is taken as 0.15. So this was the base that we laid for the superrelation. Now we'll be actually coming to the concept of superrelation. So now you all know superrelation is nothing but when the centrifugal force comes into picture. So to counteract that centrifugal force, the outer edge of the pavement is raised over the inner edge. So that transverse slopes which comes into picture due to this raising of outer edge over the inner edge, that is nothing but the superrelation. And the same you can see on this figure on the right hand side. So this dotted line ML, if you see, so that's the level road without any superrelation. And what is superrelation is nothing but this inclination that you are providing to the road. So this outer edge N, it is raised over the inner edge M. So this inclination which comes into picture, the theta, that is nothing but the superrelation value. So here for representation purpose, I have taken truck as the vehicle because its size is more, so we can accommodate all the points in it. The CG and all the forces can be seen clearly. And if I go into the mathematical part of this figure, so this is nothing but simply a triangle with some angle theta over here, and here you have a 90 degree. You can consider this NL as 90 degree. So from the trigonometrics of this triangle, NL upon ML is equal to tan theta. If I find out the value of E, so E is equal to NL upon ML, and that is nothing but tan theta. And in practice, this theta value is very small. We will be looking shortly into it, that it's as small as 0.07 or 7% is the value. So the tan theta, it comes out to be very small, and that practically it equates to sine theta. So we can replace this tan theta by sine theta. Okay. And sine theta for this triangle, if I work out, it comes out to be E upon B. So basically this is the equation that we get, that capital E is equal to small E into B, where B is the width of the roadway. Okay. And E is the amount by which we are giving the superrelation. So yeah, this should be the E value. This should be the capital E. Okay. So this is the equation that we'll be using somewhere in the design aspect or in the numericals. So capital E is equal to small E into B, where small E is nothing but a superrelation in terms of tan theta, and B is the width of the roadway. Then coming to the analysis part. Now analysis part is also pretty much simple one. All we have to do is we have to consider some forces which are acting on your system while, or acting on your vehicle while it is taking a turn, and then we balance out the forces so that we maintain the equilibrium and we do not want our vehicle to overturn or skid. And after we balance the forces, then whatever equation we get, that is nothing but the equation that we use for finding out the superrelation value. So again, I'll consider this scenario that my vehicle, in this case it's a truck I've taken for example. So this vehicle is traversing on a curve, horizontal curve, and this is the inner side, this is the outer side of that curve. Inner side is nothing but towards the center, and outer side is away from the center. And now I have provided a superrelation, or have tilted or inclined, or provided the inclination of theta to this roadway. So the forces which are acting on this vehicle, which is moving on a horizontal curve, and that curve is having a radius of r, and this vehicle, it is moving at a speed of v meter per second. That is the assumption that I have taken for deriving the equation. So if I consider this as the CG of this vehicle, okay, in front view, whatever location is there for the CG. So if this is the CG, so basically the first force which will be acting, that is the centrifugal force P, which is acting horizontally outwards through the CG. Okay, that this we have seen yesterday itself, that a centrifugal force, it acts horizontally outwards, okay, or radially outwards through the center of gravity of the vehicle. And if I just resolve this force, centrifugal force, because it is acting horizontally, and this horizontal is parallel to the level surface, but actually we are providing a tilt to our road. Okay. So the axis of the vehicle, of this truck, they also become inclined through the same angle theta. So if I resolve this centrifugal force P on those axis of vehicle, inclined axis of vehicle, so I get P cos theta and P sin theta. Then the second force which is acting on your vehicle, it is the self-weight W, which is trying to restore your overturning moment. Okay. And this W, again, it is acting vertically downwards. And again, if I resolve this W along the axis of the vehicle, I get W sin theta and W cos theta. So this theta is same. Okay, the inclination, whatever inclination we provide to the road surface, the same inclination is there between the vertical axis and the vertical axis of the system and vertical axis of the vehicle. Okay, so vehicle axis is tilted a bit because the vehicle itself is tilted. Okay. Now, though this tilt, it may seem a lot of tilt in this picture, but actually this tilt is very small. Okay, for just for understanding purpose, I have exaggerated the amount of inclination. Okay, so this is not to the scale diagram. And then the third force which is coming into picture, that is the frictional forces at the tire. So if you recall, what we have done is we have considered all those forces which will overturn your vehicle, or which will try to overturn your vehicle, or try to transversely skid your vehicle. So whatever two effects of centrifugal force we had seen in the previous lecture, so the same two effects we have considered here also, and all the forces in both the systems we have considered together. So we are not considering overturning effect separately and the transverse skidding effect separately. So this is the force system, and due to this frictional force, obviously there will be a reaction, because there is a downward self weight of this vehicle, of the truck. So obviously your pavement or the road, it will be giving a supporting reaction, Ra and Rb, at the locations. A and B are nothing but, I have named the two wheels of the vehicle. This is wheel A and this is wheel B, suppose. So this is the initial stage for the analysis. We have now made it very clear that what are the forces which are acting on my vehicle, and now we are in position to balance out these forces so that we can come up with an equation. So again, considering the same diagram, force or free body diagram, if I now consider the equilibrium condition, so in equilibrium condition, what I have to do is I have to just balance out the forces left for the forces towards the left should be forces towards the right, so that the transverse skidding is not there, and also the forces in the vertical directions, they should balance out each other, so that again the vehicle is on track. So in that sense, if I start with for equilibrium condition, so firstly I am starting with the horizontal forces. So on the right side, or the forces towards the right, we have only one force, that is this cos component of your centrifugal force, P cos theta. So that will be equal to all the forces which are towards the left or towards the inner side of the system. So on the left side, we have the sine component of self weight, W sine theta. We have the frictional forces FA and FB acting at the wheels of the vehicle. So I have considered those, that P cos theta is equal to W sine theta plus FA plus FB. Now yesterday we had seen FA and FB, we can write it in form of lateral coefficient of friction into the reaction coming on that wheel, respective wheel. So FA is nothing but small f, lateral coefficient of friction, into the reaction at wheel A, and FB is nothing but lateral coefficient of friction into reaction at wheel B. So I have just taken the F term common, and then again Ra and Rb I can substitute as Ra plus Rb. If I do the combination, So vertical forces, there are only two vertical forces in the upward direction, that is RA and RB. And those vertical forces in upward direction have to be balanced by the vertical forces in the downward direction in the same plane. So downward direction, we have two forces, P sine theta and W cos theta. So instead of RA plus RB, I can write W cos theta plus P sine theta. I'm simply doing this because we want our equation in terms of either self weight or centrifugal force, because we have a substitution for centrifugal force. We know that P by W is equal to V square upon GR. That is the centrifugal ratio. So we are simply converting our equation into terms of P, W and thetas. So this is the equation that comes out after substitution. And then I have just again rearranged the terms which have the centrifugal force in their value, I have taken them on left hand side, and the terms which are having self weight, I have taken on the right hand side. So this is that step. And then now to simplify things, because all the theta values, if you see in this equation, those are either in cos or in sine. But in the previous slide, we have seen that superelation, it is given by tan theta. The inclination is given by tan theta. So if there is tan theta in this equation, then it will be easy for us to just simply write small e instead of that tan theta. So dividing whole equation by cos theta, so I'll be getting this cos theta will cancel out. This will turn out into tan theta. Again, this will turn out into tan theta, and this cos theta will be canceling out. And obviously there is a W, so your W will also be cancelled out, and here we'll be getting P by W. So this is the equation that we get after dividing and writing in terms of tan. So P by W is equal to 1 minus F tan theta is equal to tan theta plus F. Now this equation makes some sense, because we know that P, we can write P by W in some form of speed and radius, and then we have tan theta which we can substitute by small e. Okay, so simply by rearranging the terms, taking all the trigonometrical terms and F values on right side, so I get this. Now again, here we are making one assumption that the value of coefficient of lateral friction, it is 0.15 that we are taking, and the tan theta, it hardly exceeds 7% or 0.07. Okay, that's the maximum values. Just in exceptional cases, we take 10% or 0.1, but in 99% of the scenario, we take maximum value of tan theta or superelation as 0.07. So if I find out F tan theta by that sense, so you can also do it on your calci if you have it. So F tan theta, it comes out to be almost equal to or approximately 0.01. And then if I find out this term, 1 minus F tan theta, so it comes out to be almost around 0.99, and then I can round it up to 1. Okay. Now this I am doing only because I want to simplify this bracket. I don't want this 1 minus F tan theta into the picture. So I am simplifying it. So instead of 1 minus F tan theta, I can simply write this as 1, and then my equation will be simply P by W is equal to E plus F. So this tan theta, I have replaced it by small e. Remember, this height, actually the height dimension or the distance dimension by which the inclination is given, that is capital E. And this tan theta or this inclination theta, if I find out the tan of this, so that tan theta is equal to small e. Okay, so do not confuse between small e and capital E. Capital E is the actual distance by which the outer edge is raised. That's the capital E, and small e is the inclination or the angular measurement that we are finding out the tan of that angular measurement. Okay, so P by W comes out to be E plus F. Now we know P by W is nothing but the centrifugal ratio. So we, instead of P by W, I can write V square upon GR, because I will be knowing the speed of the vehicle, or I will be knowing the design speed of my highway, and I will be knowing the radius of the horizontal curve that I am providing. So it will be more meaningful if I write my equation in terms of speed and radius. And then simply just rearranging, E plus F is equal to V square upon जी यार, सो दिस इज योर फाइनल इक्वेशन फॉर सुपर रिलेशन इन विच यू हैव दिस सुपर रिलेशन स्मॉल ई. जस्ट टू गिव द टर्म्स हियर, सो ई इज योर रेट ऑफ सुपर रिलेशन विच इज नथिंग बट टैन थीटा स्मॉल ई. एफ इज द कोएफिशिएंट ऑफ लैटरल फ्रिक्शन एंड दैट्स 0.15. वी इज द स्पीड ऑफ व्हीकल इन मीटर पर सेकेंड एंड आर इज द रेडियस ऑफ दैट हॉरिजॉन्टल कर्व दैट वी हैव डिजाइंड इन मीटर्स. And g is the acceleration due to gravity, which has its value of 9.8. So now again, like we had seen in SSD and OSD, this formula is there for speed value in meter per second. But we know many of the times we have to deal with the speed values in km page because that's the speed that we take as a design speed for any highway. So if I just convert this equation so that I can accommodate the speed value directly in km page. So substituting that 0.278 the factor and then substituting the value of g as 9.8, I get e plus f is equal to v square upon 127 r. So this is again the same equation, e plus f is equal to v square upon gr or e plus f is equal to capital v square upon 127 r. Both equations are one and the same. The only difference is in this first equation, whatever is the speed value that we are considering or that we take as meter per second value, and in the second equation, whatever speed value we take, that we take in kmph. So that's the only difference from exam point of view, from competitive exams and the ones having time limits. So you can remember this value because most of the time they give the speed values in kmph. So e plus f is equal to v square upon 127 r, and as I told you, v in kmph and the radius remains in meter as it is. Now coming to the values, so the maximum value of this e, it is 0.07 as I told you earlier, and the minimum value of f is 0.15. So if you see, there is a peculiarity why I have given these two statements, that maximum value of e, it is 0.07 and minimum value of f is 0.15. So if you see the difference, it's drastic that the minimum value of f, it is actually twice the maximum value of e. And we had seen in the yesterday's lecture that there are two effects due to centrifugal force. One is the overturning effect and another is the transverse skidding. And then we said that to avoid this overturning and transverse skidding, then we were providing the superrelation. But if you see here, so that superrelation is playing a less important role, you can say, as compared to the lateral coefficient of friction. I am not saying that superrelation doesn't have any role. I am merely comparing between the frictional factor, lateral frictional coefficient, and the superrelation. So amongst these two, if I have to choose, you are told that no, you cannot provide superrelation, or either you have to provide superrelation, or either you can provide a rough surface. So if you are told to choose between these two, so remember that you should go for a rough surface if you are not able to provide a superrelation, because clearly you can see the contribution of this lateral friction, it is more than the contribution of superrelation, and this contribution is for counteracting the centrifugal force. So that's what the main purpose of the superrelation is, that we are providing that inclination in the pavement because we have to counteract the centrifugal force. And if I know that my lateral friction is contributing more than my superrelation, so if I have a chance or if I have a choice in front of me, that either one of two, so I'll surely go for the lateral friction. So this is an important thing to remember, not remember but to understand, that it's a logical thing that you can just simply make out from the values of maximum value of E and minimum value of F. And then again, in some situations, it is not possible to provide superrelation. Now you will the situations in which it is not possible, I have written one instance here, that intersections, suppose you have a three-leg intersection, okay, in which a main road is meeting a minor road, or you have a four-leg intersection, both the roads can be major road or both the roads can be one can be major and one can be minor. So if these intersections are only curve portion, suppose this is a curve. Okay, I have just exaggerated the curve. Okay, and then you have a straight one, something like this. Okay, so it generally we don't do such kind of geometrics or alignment where our intersection is on a curve portion. But if it is there, so whatever is the superposition that you need for this curve, you have to provide on this intersection as well. Okay, in this portion, suppose. But now this is the common portion for this road also, and this road might be a straight road which is not requiring any superposition. So in that case, there will be a very improper kind of geometrics, and it will cause a lot of disturbance to the or inconvenience to the vehicles as well, or the drivers as well. So at intersections, we try to restrict the superposition. So in that case, if suppose that intersection is there on a superposition path and you have nothing to do, so in that case what we can do is we can only provide the lateral friction. Okay, so we provide the surface a little bit rough. Okay, you either make it rough by making that intersection of a paver block or making that intersection of a concrete surface, cement concrete surface. So cement concrete has more roughness than the surface roughness than the bitumen surface. So in this way you can provide the lateral friction and then make sure that your centrifugal force is counteracted fully. So in that case, my equation of E plus F is equal to V square upon 127 R, that will no longer be true because you don't have that E component. So just by making it zero, it will be F is equal to V square upon 127 R, and if I just find out the value of V by rearranging the terms, it gives me V is equal to under root 127 FR. Now this is nothing but a restricted speed. So many of the times you might also have seen this, that at some intersections you have a speed limit sign that you might be coming or traveling the highway with 80 km/h, but at intersections they ask you to reduce the speed. So one obvious reason is because you have a interfering traffic, but other than that also you have to restrict the speed so that if that intersection is on a curve portion, so your vehicle will not overturn because we have reduced our superposition to zero in that intersection. So whole and sole responsibility of counteracting the centrifugal force comes on your friction factor, and if you have more speed, then there will be the frictional force will not be that much into picture. Okay, so that's why at intersections we restrict this speed. Okay, so remember this also, or understand this, that where there is no superposition, we restrict the speed of your vehicle. Okay, so that's where the speed limit sign comes into picture. So this is all related to the analysis of superposition, and just to set the limits now, the maximum superposition, as I have been telling you for the past three to four slides, that this maximum superposition in plain terrain or rolling terrain or snowbound areas, it is maximum 7%. Okay, we don't go beyond it because then that will cause a lot of inclination in the road surface. Okay, this will be the inclined road surface, which we don't want so much inclined. Okay, but for hill roads, obviously hill roads have been always an exception for any geometrics, so same is the case for superposition as well. So in hill roads, we provide or we allow a maximum superposition of 10%, but not more than that. And in case of urban stretches where we have more intersections, so there the superposition value is lowered, as we have seen in the previous slide, that intersection demands a zero superposition ideally. But instead of zero, if we have to provide a superposition, so we don't go beyond 4%. And now you can just relate that this superposition value, maximum superposition value, and the minimum superposition value. So for minimum superposition, they have not restricted to some value, but instead what they have done is the camber that we provide. Now we have seen this term camber or cross slope in our cross sectional elements. So these are the camber values, 4%, 3%, 2.5, 2, and 1.7. So if you recall again, 1.7 was the minimum camber which was given for the cement concrete roads, and 4% was the maximum for the earthen roads. And bituminous road rate is somewhere between 2.5 to 2. So for these camber values, these are the radius of curves. Okay, all these values what you see, 50, 70, 100, 140, and so on. These are the value of the radius of horizontal curve. So if my radius, it is greater than this value, so if it is equal to this value or greater than this value corresponding to the design speed, then you don't require to provide a super elevation. There your camber itself, whatever you are providing, you can just suppose I am providing 2% camber, so that 2% itself I can just give it like this in one direction. Instead of giving it in two direction, I'll give it in one direction, in the direction in which you have a curve or center of the curve, and then that will be considered as the superelevation itself. So minimum superelevation, you don't have a value as such, but the camber in camber which is provided, that comes into picture. Okay, now from this maximum minimum superelevation value, just a question, that why do you think you need a limit on this maximum value and minimum value? Minimum value, I'll tell you the answer. Minimum value, obviously, because you have to drain off the water, plus you have to balance the forces, and you have to make sure that the friction itself doesn't have to take the entire load of counteracting the force, because we have seen in case of friction, what is happening is the pressure distribution is unequal, that the pressure on the outer wheel B, which we had seen, that is more than the pressure which is coming on the inner wheel. So if we don't provide a superelevation, and if we just be on the, or if we just provide a lateral friction, so in that case the wear and tear of the outer wheels will be more. So that also we don't want. So that's why we provide a minimum superelevation. And for maximum superelevation, what do you think is the reason that we limit or restrict ourselves to maximum superelevation? So this is a question to you, and you have to answer it. So that's all for today. I'll stop here. And then in the next lecture, we'll be starting with the design of superelevation. Now, what we saw now, just now, was the analysis part, which was just to find out the formula, which will be used for finding out a superelevation. But now we have to design a superelevation. So there is a bit difference in designing a superelevation and analysis of superelevation. So that difference, and actually what is design, that will be seen in the next lecture. So that's all for today.